Our job team's job is to make sure people that are using Google developer products are happy and successful. And this show is all about AppScript. Our main purpose here is to answer your questions. So if you're watching live, you can either join the live hangout, come join me, and we'll answer some questions. Or if you don't feel like joining, if you're a little shy, you can go to the embedded moderator page, which is inside of this event, and start typing your questions there. And I'll go through them during the show. So before we get started with questions and answers, I wanted to just cover a little bit of some news that's happened recently in the AppScript community. So one thing is that we recently published a blog post, early this week, rather, on Monday, about how it's very exciting, actually, the UK, their cabinet office, the ministers in that office, are actually using, well, not the ministers programming themselves, but the part of the more techie members of their office actually have been putting together a solution to create custom reports on their Google Analytics data. So they have a number of, I guess, different web properties that they're trying to monitor analytics on. And you know, the ministers need their information in a certain format that on a daily basis that they can kind of easily digest and get some information about. And so for that purpose, they put together some AppScript code that pulls a report directly from Google Analytics using the integration that's in AppScript, puts that into some spreadsheets, does some formatting and manipulation of the data. And then from there, they output that into a design tool that produces the final stylized report. So go check it out. It's on our blog, which is, you can search for the Google Apps Developer blog. It's probably the easy way to find it. But it's also googleappsdeveloper.blogspot.com. And just go take a look. It's actually really exciting. And we've seen a lot of people recently get success by using AppScript to kind of pull data from Google Analytics. I think people who use Google Analytics, power users, they love data. They love number crunching. And spreadsheets and AppScript is the perfect tool set to kind of comb through that data, refine it, and pull out kind of interesting metrics. So do check that out. And some other things, if you're kind of new to some of these Google Developer Live episodes we've been doing, we've done one just this week, which was an introduction to AppScript triggers. So triggers are a method by which your AppScript code can, rather than run when you tell it to, react to an event, either react to something happening in a spreadsheet or a form being submitted, or even just every once in a while, so kind of like on a regular timer. This is a great way that you can take a task, let's say, that you want to check something or manipulate something on a set period of time. Rather than having to go into some interface and click a button, triggers allow you to do it automatically. And so my colleague Ikai did a really great episode about how to use triggers. He showed off some cool demos. So you can check that out on the Google Developers YouTube channel. Just search for AppScript triggers. And along those lines, we have two other special GDLs like this coming up in the next couple of weeks. So next week, we're doing one about integrating Google AppScript with Twilio. If you haven't used Twilio, it's not a Google product. It's another company altogether that makes kind of a really developer-friendly API for interacting with SMS and voice. So it's kind of like a bridge you can use to kind of send messages to phones, receive phone calls, receive text messages. It's really powerful and allows for a lot of like cool integrations. You know, it's no longer just that your script can be stuck in a spreadsheet. It's now accessible on your phone and beyond. So it's really kind of a neat thing. And so my colleague Arun is going to be presenting on that. And you can find that on the Google Developers Live page, which you can search for. This one is called Adding Voice and SMS to Google Apps Using Twilio and AppScript. And then one more of those that we have. This is a little bit in the future now. I think it's about 2 weeks out. We're doing one on using charts dashboards with AppScript. So, you know, as we mentioned, it's usually people who love data that are doing things in AppScript. And one of the best things you can do with data is display some charts. It's a great way to just visually, in an instant, kind of see trends in the data. And so along those lines, you know, AppScript supports some capabilities of the Google Charts API. And one of those that we do support is dashboards. Dashboards are really great in that they allow you to take your data set and display one data set in a number of charts, and then add controls that allow you to dynamically filter which data is being displayed. And so that was something we added to Google AppScript a couple of months ago. And we've seen some people really excited about it. So we're going to do an episode just dedicated to charts and dashboards by my colleague Kalyan. And that'll be coming to you in a couple of weeks. So stay tuned. All of this, like I said, is on the Google Developers Live page. You can kind of go there and look for our AppScript GDLs. So that's a bit about it on the news. Let's go to your questions. Let's see if we have anybody in the Hangout that has any questions today. Hi, welcome. Does anybody in the Hangout have any questions? All right. Well, if you do have questions, feel free to chime in a little bit. We'll keep your audio on there, so just chime in, and if you have any questions, we'll answer them. But until then, feel free to just tune in and listen to what's going on. So we do have some questions in the Google Moderator, asked by some of our users ahead of time. And so there's actually some really great ones here about ScriptDb. We have two questions about ScriptDb. So ScriptDb is a built-in data store to AppScript. It's a JavaScript object data store. So it's kind of putting objects in and then querying for them later. It's not very similar to SQL. It works a little bit differently, but the same basic pattern: store something, get it back. And so the questions we have here, the first one is, in ScriptDb, if I store an object containing functions, let's say like defined in the constructor of an object, the user here noticed that they're lost when you store it and then later retrieve it from ScriptDb. He sees that the functions come back as just plain strings sometimes. He's like, is that inevitable? Is there no way to do class definitions and store those into ScriptDb? And unfortunately, the short answer there is yes, that in JavaScript, you can create objects that have both data and functions, just like you can in other programming languages. However, when you convert a JavaScript object to JSON, the JavaScript object notation, functions are not preserved. Only data is preserved. And this is kind of the underlying technology of ScriptDb. And so what it means is if you have an object that has some data and some functions, and you store it in ScriptDb, those functions are all going to be lost. It's just the nature of how JSON works, is that functional code exists when it's in memory, but it can't persist when you go to JSON. So that is a limitation. I think if you wanted to work with that, if you wanted to have complex objects, store them and bring them up later, you'd have to do a little bit of extra work. Like for instance, have the constructor for an object take in kind of all the data that was there previously, put that into the right places, and then have the rest of the functions there. So there are probably some workarounds if you're skilled with JavaScript and object-oriented programming in JavaScript, that you could put the data into ScriptDB, pull it out, and then merge it back in with the functions later. It's going to take a little bit of work, though. And then another question here about ScriptDB is they want to know, is it possible to store an object that references another one that's already been stored without having to store it once again as a copy? So I guess what they're talking about here is you have some sort of kind of upper-level object that has then maybe an array of children objects inside of it. And those children objects, he said, are already in ScriptDB, but he wants to maintain this linkage that the parent object has some children. There's no way for ScriptDB to do this automatically, where you could just tell it that this is in there, and then when you pull it out, it'll all link up again magically. Unfortunately, that's not going to happen today. ScriptDB is very straightforward in that regard. I think your best bet would be, rather than to store a copy of these objects or to hope for some linking, rather store the IDs. So if you already have stored the child objects, you got an ID at the time that you stored them. Use those IDs as keys and just store the keys inside of your parent object. So when you retrieve the parent, when you look into the array of children, you'll see there's a whole bunch of keys there. You'll then need to make a second call to ScriptDB to fetch all the children out. So when you're working with kind of a more complex object structure, it's going to take some additional requests to ScriptDB, but it's certainly possible to achieve the end result. And so the last one, another one we have here in the moderator, is somebody who's creating a script for a number of different Google sites, or creating a script that creates Google sites using the sites app that we have built into AppScript. And they're wondering, how can I test if a site already exists? And what they're using today is they're using a URL fetch, which is our service for just making basic HTTP requests, to actually fetch the site and see if there's anything there. So they know what the URL should be if the site exists, but they just don't know if it actually was created yet. And so they're fetching it to see if it's there. And they're wondering, is there a better way? I think that's actually not a terrible way. Making one HTTP request to determine if something's there is not that bad. It may be possible using SitesApp, you could fetch a list of all your sites, comb through that list, and see if the site is there or not. That's another thing you could do. But as far as which is better, I think you could go either route. Probably sticking with SitesApp is going to be the most straightforward if someone is reading your code in the future. But it's really up to your own decision making there. So that was a couple from the moderator. Just to make sure our people in the Hangout don't have any questions, I want to throw it back to them. You guys in the Hangout have any questions for me today? Any AppScript problems bugging you? All right, that's good news then if there's no problems. All right, so we do have one more question here in the moderator, which I'll field. And feel free to jump in, guys, in the Hangout if you have any additional questions. So the question here was, are there any plans to add services like voice or payment into AppScript? Certainly what we love about AppScript is it's a great way to integrate a whole bunch of Google services really easily, right? Built in, it just, you know, and it's just with no additional work required, you can access Gmail, you can access Calendar, Sites, your Docs, your Drive, your spreadsheets. It's all there. But by all, it's not everything that Google offers, right? So we do have some other services at Google, like voice, like payments, that aren't right now built into AppScript. And certainly, you know, I think part of our goal is to make sure that AppScript continues to be a great place to integrate, continues to be a great place to work with these different services. So I don't think we're ever going to shut the door on bringing on more services on board. But at this time, I really don't have any specific plans about when you could expect to see those in AppScript. I'd say that's one thing that's probably going to, if you want kind of a guideline for when you could expect to see something in AppScript, if there already is an API for it that exists outside of AppScript, it's certainly going to be a lot easier for the team to bring it into AppScript. So if you see an API that Google already produces and you want to access that same functionality in AppScript, you're probably going to have a better chance of requesting that one and seeing some action than if there never was an API in the first place, just because of how things are implemented on our side. But that was a good question, and I think, you know, as the Twilio GDL that we're doing next week indicates, integrating with voice and text is obviously an important use case for some people and really opens some doors. So it would be great if you could access Google Voice, which does some of those same functionalities, but today that's just not there. All right, so that is all the questions that I have here in the moderator. One last chance for the Hangout folks. If you have any questions, feel free to jump in now.
I want to ask a question. What is the best practice to disable all the component in a vertical panel or a form panel right now? Because there isn't a functionality to disable all the child widget of a vertical panel, for example. I mean, one call to disable all the child widget of, for example, a vertical panel, a form panel.
I'm sorry, my earpiece was a little low. I had a little trouble hearing you. So you wanted to disable certain functionality? Can you say again which functionality you were interested in?
A functionality to disable all the child widget of a form panel. For example, I have two text boxes in a form panel. When I submit, and the submit button. When I click the submit button, I want that all the widget child of the form panel, for example, will be disabled.
I see. So I guess the situation, if I'm guessing,
right now I have to store all the ID of the child widget and disable them with for example a for cycle.
Right. Yeah, I guess you have to do it individually and remember which widgets are in there. Yeah, I can see what you're saying. So is the use case that when someone clicks that button, there's going to be a little bit of a delay in the processing, and you don't want people to change the form values?
Sorry?
Like, what is the purpose of doing the disabling? Like, why is that a good thing?
I, for example, use to disable all the component in a user interface where I have to show only some part of the panel, because some people have to see a part of the panel and other people have only to edit them. So I have a different panel, and each of the panel. If the app user is part of a group, I disable or enable a form panel.
I see. Okay. Yeah. So I guess I can see that that is a little bit of extra work that you would need to. You can't just disable a whole panel at once. You have to do it on widget by widget basis. That's something we can look into as far as requesting that. I'd say that for some of the feature requests, where if it's possible to do it and it just requires a little bit of extra code, those usually aren't as high a priority when there's something that people really want to do and it's just impossible to do. So for something like this, it's still a good idea and it's still something we can definitely kind of talk to the team about. But I would say for the time being, you're probably going to have to work with what's there. But that said, about feature requests, just in case we have some people new on the Hangout on the episode today. If you use AppScript a lot and there's a feature that's really missing or that you think would be really great to have, we have an issue tracker, which is for logging both bugs with the product and also features. So if there's a feature you'd like to see, go to our issue tracker. You can get to it from our documentation, and just fill in what the feature is that you'd like to see and why you think it's really important. And then we'll continue to kind of monitor that and see if there's enough interest and if it's possible.
Okay. No, I've already reported this enhancement.
Fantastic. Yeah, we're a little behind on coming through some of those, but we're catching up this week, so hopefully we'll get to that one in just a little bit. All right, great. Let me just check the moderator one more time. Looks like there are no new questions. One last chance on the Hangout. No, sounds like we're all good. All right, well, thanks everyone for joining me today. We'll be back. I don't know if we'll be back next week. Probably not next week. But, certainly after the holidays, obviously during the holidays, things get a little complicated. But certainly after the holidays, we'll be back in the new year with a whole bunch more episodes of Office Hours. And as we mentioned, in the coming weeks, we'll also have some special editions of our AppScript episodes focused on particular topics. So in the meantime, if you have questions about how to use AppScript, me and the rest of the team, we're all on Stack Overflow, monitoring the Google-Apps-Script tag. So tag your questions with that. There's a whole great community out there of other users who will be able to help you, and we'll chime in if nobody else knows the answer. So until then, thank you very much for joining me, and I'll see you later.